first speaker is Hallvard Fossheim. Is that close, I hope? He's a professor of philosophy at the University of Bergen in Norway. He wrote his dissertation at the University of Oslo. He has published on Aristotle, on happiness, various papers, and I'm not going to read all of them here, but I'm happy to welcome him to this meeting. And the title of the paper is "Reading Socrates' Drama: Death of Drama of Death, Grief, and Argument in the Phaedo."
Thank you. Can everyone hear me? Do I need this?
No.
I think you need it for posterity, so that we be recorded.
Would it work if I just left it there? Because I think
that's fine.
Because of the record.
Yeah, good. Okay, so I'll just get straight to it then. The Republic presents a deep irrationalism of the soul. Most of the soul is irrationally motivated, messy, and fairly unaware of itself, even on a good day. Perhaps naively, I've taken the Phaedo to present the antithesis of this picture, a soul that's nicely unified and whose main characteristic is reason. I'm no longer so sure about this, however. In the next 21 minutes, I'll try to convey what seems to be a more republic-like side of the Phaedo, not in terms of tripartition, but in terms of what I take to be its picture of reason as weak, secondary, and embedded in a frame of non-rational forces on which it depends. I'll also try to say something about how this works on the level of the reader as well. The Phaedo uniquely straddles two extremes in Plato's authorship. On the one hand, it offers what is among the more concentrated packages of sophisticated arguments in Plato's productions. On the other hand, in dramatizing the death of Socrates and the reactions of those present, the Phaedo constitutes the by far most violently emotional scene that we have from Plato. I want to argue that this very contrast constitutes the Phaedo's most important philosophical contribution. In building this argument, I'll take as a point of departure that we cannot ignore the specific dramatics of the Phaedo. The drama in the dialogue shows how arguments and events are taken into human lives in a way which at the same time reminds us that even the most abstract argument always takes place in a particular setting among a certain group of individuals at a given point in their lives. What is specific, somewhat specific to the Phaedo, is not least that it offers a dramatization of grief. Before looking more into what grief means for the dialogue, however, let's consider a couple of indications of the Phaedo's topic that are provided early on in the dialogue. Before getting into the details of his story, Phaedo chooses to give Hecates a rather special perspective on the significance of what happened the day Socrates died. Hecates hadn't asked for it, but Phaedo makes a topic of his own, that is Phaedo's own, emotive reactions on the day. From Socrates being content, he explains, and I quote, "That's why I had no feeling of pity, for the man appeared happy both in manner and words as he died nobly and without fear." Hecates, so that it struck me that even in going down to the underworld, he was going with the god's blessing and that he would fare well when he got there, if anyone ever does. "That's why I had no feeling of pity, such as would seem natural in my sorrow, nor indeed of pleasure, as we engaged in philosophical discussion and as we were accustomed to do, for our arguments were of that sort. But I had a strange feeling, an unaccustomed mixture of pleasure and pain at the same time, as I reflected that he was just about to die." All of us present were affected in much the same way, sometimes laughing, then weeping, especially one of us, Apollodorus, you know the man and his ways. What I want to emphasize is that emotion, partly analyzed in terms of pleasure and pain, and now this is the end of the book, is introduced to us near the beginning of the text. On the face of it, nothing much is made of this. But remember that the whole of the Phaedo is about whether death is to be feared or not as the end of the soul, or perhaps even welcome. All the arguments that follow are motivated by this concern on the part of those present. The issue of emotive reactions and of grief, fear, and we should think pity in the face of death
is brought on once more the moment the scene of the prison is introduced. After having waited around for much of the day, his followers are finally allowed to meet Socrates. And here's the quote. "We found Socrates recently released from his chains, and some tipper, you know her, sitting by him, holding their baby. When she saw us, she cried out and said the sort of thing that women usually say. Socrates, this is the last time your friends will talk to you and you to them." Socrates looked at Plato. "Plato," he said, "let someone take her home." End of quote. Once more, we are reminded not only that someone is about to die, but that grief is the reaction of the other characters to what is happening. As if to make sure everybody gets the point, Plato lets Socrates himself to open his communication with us on the same note. Again, without any obvious link to the content of the ensuing discussion, and without any clue from something said by others, Socrates next says the following. "What a strange thing that which men call pleasure seems to be, and how astonishing the relation it has with what is thought to be its opposite, namely pain. A man cannot have both at the same time, yet if he pursues and captures the one, he is almost always bound to catch the other also, like two creatures with one head." Now, I don't think it's enough of an explanation for all of this to say that these passages form necessary and natural parts of a text about someone dying. Pain, pleasure, grief, pity, fear. There's no doubt that the whole thing could have been pulled up without mention or dramatization of any of them. They are clearly there for a reason. As far as I can tell, at least part of the reason must be to prime us to think of our status as emotive creatures. Plato is reminding us of and activating in us something pertinent to the dialogue's fugitive theme. A further element, too, has already been quoted but not commented on, and that's the fact that the nature of pleasure and pain has, at this point in the text, been held up for us as the dialogue's first puzzle. But notice that Phaedo has characterized his experience as a mixture of pleasure and pain, and here Socrates is pointing out specifically that a man cannot have both pleasure and pain at the same time. We thus seem to have mutually contradictory reports about basic emotive reactions based on the two persons' own experiences of the situation. This isn't to say that this particular question is the real topic of the dialogue or that it's given a final answer in the course of it, but by giving us a clear contradiction on the obviously central matter of emotions, one that seems to be significant for understanding what emotion is, the text has taken care to make us focus on and ask about this aspect of what's going on. What is going on? Well, first of all, it's certainly not only arguments, but fables and arguments, to use Socrates' own distinction. Again, we're given a seemingly accidental piece of information, and again, this serves to highlight what's going on in the rest of the text. This is at 61. Zeus asked what induced Socrates to write poetry after he came to the prison. Socrates has indeed been putting the fables of Aesop into verse and composing the hymn to Apollo. Besides foregrounding the phenomenon of poetic composition as an art, the answer given by Socrates is among the most dignifying, or at least down-putting, references to what we might call the production of fiction that exists in the Platonic corpus. For apparently, Socrates holds open the possibility that this is indeed what the dream meant, which told him to practice and cultivate the arts. Of course, to Socrates, the highest art is philosophy, but poetry or fiction came in as a believable number two. It's difficult not to take this as, among other things, a comment on Plato's own activity in writing, for instance, the Phaedo. As such, it serves as a reminder that one is, at the moment, reading a work of art. A work of art that is, at the same time, philosophy. The Phaedo clearly is just that, fables and arguments. So from the very beginning of reading the text, we are made to think of emotions, of pleasures and pains, and we're made to think of them as present in the text we're reading. However one takes the details of what goes on in the bulk of the dialogue, all or most would agree that questions about the soul are central. It's famously stated that practicing philosophy in the right way is practicing dying and death. And this means not only learning to not fear death, although that would be part of it. The basis for not fearing death is not having reason to fear it, because one has managed to free one's soul from the body. Without this, one would still both be and think of oneself as an embodied being, that is, a being that will be destroyed upon death.
and death and its consequences will not be cozy for such a person. At birth, the soul is tied to the body, but through the way one lives, one can further contribute to tying one's self, that is one's soul, to the body through habits and modes of thinking and living. Or one can live the life of a philosopher and escape all that. This aspect of the dialogue is well known, and I will not dwell on it. Notice, however, that the pleasures of sex are mentioned at 64 D and E as one of the things the true philosopher despises. And keep in mind that Xantippe was just at the prison with their baby. The characters in the Phaedo have an ideal to live up to that, with the exception of Socrates, they do not realize. Possibly exception of Socrates. The central virtues, moderation, courage, wisdom, and justice, each have a shadow version, which is bubbly. And the real version that's proper to the perfected philosopher. This is part of the sense of references to popular and social virtue coming about by habit and practice, in the case of, for instance, moderation and justice. Mystic rites are throughout evoked as a suitable simile to the process of perfection through philosophy. This too gives the impression of somehow transcending mere human life or something that in the Phaedo is divine and found in death, if ever. The famous child inside is probably best understood as part of this non-perfected economy of the bodified soul. The child's foremost quality seems to be fear of death and dying. But probably both apologies that are spelled out as revealing shortcomings of the unperfected could be attributed to it. First, there is being ruled by pleasure and pain. This is a feature which, while bodily, is really of a non-perfected soul, which is itself bodily. What we might think of in terms of wrongful actualization of the potentials or possibilities of the soul makes the soul corporeal. This, in turn, is what returns us to pleasure and pain. I'm not going to argue that tripartition is cyclically in play in the Phaedo, but if these descriptions smack of appetite, if it's a mere, as a principle of motivation, then Thymos too is represented a bit later on, when the quote from the Odyssey seems to entail that these emotive aspects of non-perfected agency are in fact bodily, that of 94b. So at least a recognizable manifold of motivations and emotive forces is set up here, no matter what the details of the model might be. With the impressive exception of Socrates, we're all, it seems, children in need of comfort. What is particularly striking, however, is that is what form the comfort takes. Says Socrates, you should sing a charm over him every day until you have charmed away his fears. In what does this charm consist then, and why is it necessary? One might think that the charm is necessary only because of personal weakness on the part of some individuals, a few rotten apples, as it were. But the text suggests another approach. The myth, starting at 107b, is perhaps the strongest candidate for a charm, an image as placeholder for firm arguments, a vision of a just cosmos where the perfect soul would need no such tale. But that myth is not introduced simply because of individual's weakness, although that too plays into it. The myth is first approached because the arguments aren't sufficient on their own. They are hypothetical arguments incapable of securing safe knowledge. In turn, these hypothetical arguments seem to have been introduced because there were no non-hypothetical arguments available that could do the job of securing knowledge. The earlier arguments for the immortality of the soul certainly rest on hypotheses, besides they're not establishing anything like the survival of individual souls. This suggests that the relation between reason and the rest of the soul is at least a complicated one. Reason, in even good people, isn't capable of going on its own. And furthermore, and much more interesting perhaps, reason needs techniques directed at the other aspects of soul in order to have established even arguments. While the presentation of the myth, with its detailed geography and moral map of the world, we see Socrates reverting to what he has just previously said no longer interests him. As he says, when I was a young man, I was wonderfully keen on that wisdom which they call natural science. By the end of the dialogue, he's back to speculating, with a moral twist, of course, about the Earth's middle position in the cosmos, without providing much by way of argument for it, and even much less for the claims that follow. Similarly, one is apparently forced to regress to the inner child in order to move closer to truth and knowledge. No wonder Socrates inserts a specific reminder to not let oneself turn into a missalot, because one finds out that the arguments simply aren't good enough to do what they were supposed to do. This is a timely reminder indeed, coming as it does before seemingly solid arguments give way to hypotheticals, which again yield to myth. By the end of the dialogue, the moralizing myth is described as a belief worth risking, nothing more. The entire gamut of effects is set up to charm our inner child. Perhaps the language of the mystic initiation, which suffuses the dialogue as a whole, is all along meant to provide a clue to this state of affairs. In mystic initiation too, one must be shown things and let them work on one. A crucial aspect of grief, as of other emotions, is its social power over humans. The Phaedo clearly displays the workings of what we might call a mimetic impulse, although it's not called that in the text. To quote, Apollodorus hadn't ceased from weeping before, and at this moment his noisy tears and anger made everybody present break down, except Socrates, end of quote. The setting apart of Socrates' response, while indicating an ideal beyond what is normally human, also serves to emphasize the universality of the other's responses. What is of particular interest in this respect is the claim that it's Apollodorus' display of grief and anger which makes the others enter into their own similar reactions. This adds to the picture of human agents as emotive, dependent, and heteronomous. Overall, this mimetic impulse is presented as a main threat to the ideal of rationality expounded by Socrates, and as a main mode by which irrationality takes over the individual. At the same time, the division forces us to recognize, on the moral psychological level, a dualism definitive of the characters of the Phaedo. One principal controlling part of their thoughts and behavior is rationality, another acknowledged in the dialogue in terms of the child within is emotionally charged and mimetic in structure. It's crucial to see that the relation between reasoned argument and the emotive reaction in no way could amount to an either-or, however. Not least, the extreme infiltration of the moral psychological principles is revealed in how rational argument itself is repeatedly characterized as a charm and supposed to work as such. And notice also that the philosopher, Socrates, too has an emotive reaction, but one of calmness and friendliness combined with mild exasperation at the other's lack of control. The dramatic dimension of the argument thus demonstrates how two principles, still parts of psychological aspects, are activated together in any exchange, however rational. The insight about the psychological setup of the dialogue's characters has a major impact on how we must understand its function on the level of the work as work. Plato wrote each dialogue as dialogue for one or several purposes. In the case of the Phaedo, the drama and the argument find a grounding link in how the dialogue forces the reader to respond to her own responses, that is, to self-reflectively experience two aspects or parts of her own soul and their degree of conflict. An emotive reaction is a crucial part of what the text is designed to invoke, both by narrative structure, a good and familiar man is about to die, and by the narrative of grief, depiction of others' reactions. Put in a slightly oversimplified manner, the Phaedo works as a test and reminder of the reader's moral psychological setup. Confrontation with oneself that is at the same time an occasion to reflectively engage with one's own motivational constitution. We can perhaps tentatively conclude that the Phaedo is designed as something like a reader test and source of reflection caused by being forced to confront one's own dual nature. In the Phaedo, rational argument definitely has an important place, but that place is a crucially embedded and dependent one. The putatively sound, abstract arguments give way to hypotheses, dependent and conditional thoughts, and what they depend on turns out to be myth and chance in the dialogue's third wave of undermining autonomous rationality. Thank you.
Thank you. We have time for a few questions before the next paper. Questions?
Can y'all hear me?
Yeah.
I really liked your paper a lot, and I particularly liked what you said near the end about the rational and the argument being embedded within the structure of the dialogue. And I just wondered if you would talk a little bit about maybe something about the nature of narrative itself as being especially suitable for this dual presentation of, let's say, emotion and reason.
Well, actually, that's something I probably should have thought much more about than I have. And what springs to mind to me is of course, Aristotle's sort of theory around this, how a story invokes emotions as part of the sort of cognitive reaction to whatever is happening. Now, of course, there would be other things too that can bring a reaction, because part of what's called the myth in the Phaedo isn't so much a narrative. I mean, it takes time to tell this whole, to describe the map, as it were. But the map isn't a narrative as in a storyline. It's just a vision, a picture of things that gives you an intellectual and emotive reaction. So I guess, you know, that would be my sort of 25-cent version of a response, that narrative has this particular quality of bringing out understanding and emotion, but that it's not the only way of doing it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Not even when you talk about it.
Thank you, Hallvard. I just want to ask, what about Socrates? I mean, I may have missed it, but is there any evidence in the text that he needs these extra rational enchantments to gain the calm that he clearly has? Mm.
Good one.
Yeah. Yeah.
Excellent.
Good one. Let's just ponder it.
That moment with Phaedo when he's stroking his hair, that seems to be such a emotional sort of personal.
Yes, but that too is sort of emotional, not just as Socrates in himself, but as Socrates relating to and helping someone else.
Yeah.
So it seems that that's again, it's the same. It's a new version of the old story we can see how Socrates relates to others, but that means that we don't really know what he's doing for himself and what he's doing in relating to others somehow. So he does use the sort of inclusive we a lot, but what we need as human beings and so on. But he may just be thinking what you guys need. I'm some other place. But then again, I like to think that he needs it too in a way. But I can't see that the text is unambiguous. So that's just a sort of a matter of perhaps taste or just trying to draw the most coherent picture or something. So that would be my take on it. But I don't believe that I have a proper argument for it.
Thank you. Do you have any thoughts about the relationship with tragedy? We're thinking about the fact that what some people said, this is the very last time you're seeing your friends. That's actually a tragic formula. You find it so often in tragedy. It's even the object of parody in Aristophanes. And back to the first question, maybe narration may be a way to present such things in such a way that they're not dangerous. And second, do you have any thoughts about the fact that this is the only dialogue where Socrates laughs? Which is something that I've always has always confused me. He laughs twice, and these are the only instances in the entire poem. So strange and emotional in some way.
The Xanthippe thing. I mean, many others know much more about tragedy as an art form of genre than I do, but. But if it's meant as a clear hint at a different genre, then a lot hinges on how we are to take Xanthippe in the Phaedo. And I think it's been quite common to think of her as just a sort of annoying, ranting, screaming person, but she's really doing exactly what all the others are doing. And that's even pointed out by Socrates at one point, that's why we got rid of the women, so that we could do this in a decent manner.
And it just seems obvious that he's, you know, most of it just has the only sensible response to any of this, really. So that would be sort of what it hangs on. On the Socrates laughing, I don't have a clever answer except that, you know, as to the extent that this is about emotive reactions, in a way he's got an emotive reaction, but he's just demonstrating a completely different mood or setting down all of the others, which is not to say that there is no emotive setting or no mood, it's just that he's in a very different place in a way than from the others.
Thank you. I'm going to take my chair's prerogative and ask a quick question here. I'm wondering whether what you're suggesting isn't a version of what in the Republic is called the summers. The middle finger is both larger and smaller, larger than the small finger and smaller than the finger next to it, right? So it's and it's the idea that these opposites are intrinsically associated somehow in different ways, as you suggested. Pleasure and pain are associated, and what we need to do is somehow go to a world where we can make an actual separation, which is not the physical world. So that struck me as similar, but that raised a question in my mind about how it is that Socrates could somehow invoke rationality as a way of somehow resolving this. Because if pleasure and pain are intrinsically connected with each other, how does it work that by doing philosophy and being rational, we're going to overcome something that's completely different?
Here I have even less than that. I haven't even thought about this. It's very interesting that you mentioned this, that there is a sort of similarity between the contrasts that come out in the dialogue and these questions of the same and the different. So that's just, that's an interesting observation that really should have been through the dialogue looking for that. And I think that's pretty much all I have on that question. It's a good one.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Our next speaker is Roslyn Weiss, who is unfortunately ill. Her paper is going to be read by Will Altman, but I'm going to say just a word about Roslyn. She is the Sarah Stewart Professor of Philosophy at Lehigh University. She earned a doctorate from Columbia, and she has a further degree in Jewish studies from the Baltimore Hebrew University. She works on both medieval philosophy and ancient philosophy. She's written four books on Socrates, and I'm sure that you're familiar with them. So with that, I'll call on Will Altman to read her paper.
Well, I'm not going to ask that you imagine that I am the lovely Roslyn Weiss, but I do think it's important in hearing the paper that you do imagine Roslyn Weiss. Roslyn Weiss has white hair that flows girlishly down to her shoulders and has the angelic voice of a schoolgirl and yet is razor sharp. And this paper is clearly designed to be read by Roslyn Weiss. If no other proof is needed, I would just call your attention in advance to the way the word shameless is used, which I will not be able to read the way she would be able to say that, with absolute bonhomie and mildness. So with that said, this is called Fear of Death in Plato's Phaedo, paren, and Apology. What is Socrates' reason for not fearing death? How integral is his putative belief in the soul's immortality to his cheerfulness and calm in the face of impending death, a phenomenon highlighted in the Phaedo, but noted as well in the Apology and Crito? It will be argued below that Socrates' sanguinity in the face of death is nearly entirely unrelated to the question of the soul's fate after death, for what he held in the Apology at 29a to be, namely, that neither he nor any other human being can know if death is a good thing or a bad, remains in full force in Phaedo. At Phaedo 84a to B, Socrates describes the philosopher's soul as one that has been freed from the tyranny of pleasure and pain, lives in accordance with reason, and gazes upon and is nurtured by what is true and divine and not subject to opinion. As a consequence of its freedom from pleasure and pain, and its nurture by the true and divine, Socrates maintains that the philosopher's soul believes that it ought to continue to live in the same way for as long as it is alive, and that after death it will join that to which it is akin, leaving human ills behind. A soul of this kind, nurtured in this way, he further contends, would hardly fear its dissipation or dispersion or non-existence upon its separation from the body. Keebes, however, thinks in the absence of proof of the soul's immortality, it is foolish not to fear death. Indeed, according to Socrates' uncontested recapitulation of Keebes' view at 95b2c, Keebes holds that the philosopher's confidence that he will fare better in Hades as a result of the kind of life he has led in this world is misplaced. If there are insufficient grounds for the belief that the soul lives on in Hades, Keebes therefore challenges Socrates at 87b88c to prove that the soul is not simply long-lasting, but that it is immortal, that is, that it will outlive any body it inhabits. In taking up Keebes' challenge at Phaedo 96a, Socrates provides an autobiographical sketch in which he records his disappointment with Anaxagoras. As Socrates reports, Anaxagoras, despite having assigned to Nous the loftiest perch within his natural causal hierarchy, nevertheless fails to put it to use. All the real work, Socrates complains, is done in Anaxagoras' scheme by such elements as air, ether, and water. Socrates, for his part, is convinced that there can only be one real cause, all other proposed causes being in effect only necessary conditions, things without which a cause could not be a cause. The sole genuine cause, he maintains, is what is best at 97d. If only Anaxagoras had explained natural phenomena in terms of what is best, Socrates would have been satisfied. As things stand, however, he is compelled to look elsewhere. We might say, then, that what Socrates had really hoped to find in Anaxagoras was lowercase nous, a kind of intelligence at work in the universe akin to that which guided Socrates in his decision to remain in prison, the kind that guided or misguided the Athenians in their decision to convict Socrates and put him to death. The ensuing discussion is puzzling for several reasons, not the least of which is that, in providing his own account of causation, Socrates utterly neglects the matter of what is best. There is no trace in what follows of lowercase nous as a cause, yet Socrates offers no explanation beyond his personal frustration for abandoning the search for a teleological cause in favor of what looks to be a purely formal one. He supplies safe causes and then somewhat more daring ones, but not a single cause that he advances has anything to do with either rationality or reason. Although the first set of causes Socrates cites contains the beautiful itself by itself paired with the good, he immediately adds the big, along with all the rest. If one had expected Socrates to credit the beautiful and the good with influencing the cosmos and its contents in accordance with what is best, as Socrates expected Anaxagoras to do with his nous, one cannot but be deeply disappointed in Socrates, as Socrates was in Anaxagoras. Instead of air, ether, and water, we hear about a whole array of causes, from beauty itself to the big and the small, to the even and two-ness, to the odd and three, to heat and cold, to fire and snow, and finally to life and soul. Why is someone taller than someone else? Not to be sure because of a head, but also not because it is best to be so. He is so indeed because of tallness. Why are there two men when one thing is added to another? Why are there two when one thing is added to another? Not because of addition, but also not because of what is best. Two arises because of two-ness. In this entire discussion, goodness and intelligence cause nothing. It is true, of course, that Socrates introduces his formal causal account with the caveat that it is a deuteros plus, a second segment, a second essence. Interestingly, in so characterizing his view, Socrates in effect pursues the course of inquiry Simmias had charted at 85 CD. Young Simmias, a person who was just about the least likely, with the possible exception of Keynes, to succumb to mythology, prefaces his presentation of his final criticism of Socrates' defense of the immortality of the soul as follows. No one, he says, can have precise knowledge in this matter, since such knowledge is impossible or exceedingly difficult to attain in the present life. But one must persist, testing proposed views in every way. One who abandons the search is malthus, weak or soft. One must either learn or discover how things stand. If these two avenues prove impossible, one must select the best and most irrefutable of human loci and, quote, embarking on this, sail through diocusi, the dangers of life upon a raft, close quote. It is surely this voyage that Socrates has in mind when he speaks of his own deuterosophus, the one to which he has recourse when he, as he says, could neither learn from another nor discover on his own the teleological cause he sought. For Simmias, however, even, quote, the best and most irrefutable of human loci, close quote, is no more secure than a flimsy raft, and hence not a reliable support as one navigates the dangers of life. His preference is for divine logos, a firmer vessel on which one would make the journey more safely, aphalesperon, and less riskily, akin to noteron. Note, however, that the logos that Socrates touts as safest, and is the one he presents as his own, namely, the thesis that forms are causes. It is this one, he thinks, in which the fearful inquirer takes refuge. And Socrates deems safe as well, even the more refined consulta causes that he subsequently identifies, such as fire and snow, 2 and 3, even if they are not quite as safe as the first set of, quote, safe and ignorant, asphale, and kai amathe, causes such as cold, hot, but how much more satisfying is Socrates' account than Anaxagoras? Relinquishing his hope of finding the right sort of account, an account in terms of what is best, Socrates will produce an account that is necessarily not quite right, even giving several indications that he is less than enamored of his own soon-to-be-proposed thesis. First, as he introduces his foray into natural philosophy and his fruitless encounter with Anaxagoras, he characterizes his own view as confused, a jumble, filled at 97b, and by so designating it, Socrates anticipates that it will be guilty of the very misstep with which he is about to charge the antilogikoi in 100c, that of jumbling together, phloroio, a starting point or principle or premise, arche, with what follows from it. In addition, as we noted, Socrates later says in 105c1 of his explanation in terms of forms, not merely that it is safe, but that it is safe and ignorant. It is an explanation he clings to. He clings to, quote, simply and artlessly, haplos kai atechnos, and at the argument's conclusion with Kibis, when Kibis confesses to having some reservations about the argument, Socrates, far from protesting, approves. Indeed, Socrates' safe formal argument can be faulted at almost every turn. Having secured his interlocutor's agreement to the view that there are forms, Socrates proceeds to dismiss some of the more common explanations of, for example, a thing's being beautiful. Rather than account for its beauty in terms of, say, its color and shape, Socrates opts for the contentless and uninformative explanation that it is beautiful by sharing in the beautiful. One wonders if this cause, though surely safe enough, and perhaps precisely because of its safeness, is itself anything more than a necessary condition, as were Anaxagoras' air, water, and ether, and for that matter, Socrates' bones and sinews, without which his sitting in prison, rather than escaping to Megara or Boeotia, would not have been possible. For to say that something is beautiful by the beautiful is arguably not to explain at all why it is beautiful. It is only to specify that without that which it could not be beautiful. To be sure, answers such as, quote, by a head to the question of what causes one person to be taller than another, or by coming together to what causes there to be two, generate contradictions, and are not only less safe, but also worse answers than by tallness or by tootiness. And color and shape are certainly worse accounts than by the beautiful, of why something is beautiful, because these fall short of supplying even necessary conditions. Nevertheless, to say by tallness or by tootiness or by the beautiful is not to explain. One wonders, too, if forms are needed at all in this argument, or if, by introducing them, Socrates may not be committing the very fallacy of which he accuses the Antilogike at 101b, namely, that of mixing together a discussion of the starting point, okay, with what ensues from it, or is spurred by it, por reminal. For if Socrates' starting point is forms, and if the notion spurred by the positing of forms is the idea that opposites don't admit opposites, then his starting point is, strictly speaking, unnecessary, as are all his complex assertions concerning relations between, say, the form hot and its opposite, between the non-form of fire that brings heat in us and its opposite, and between heat in us and the opposite of the form hot that the non-form fire brings with it. Socrates could simply have said that just as fire, whose function is to heat, cannot admit cold, but must either perish or depart at the onset of cold, so too the soul, whose function is to make alive, could admit death, but must perish or depart at death's approach. Yet another problem with Socrates' argument involves his shameless introduction of two options, perishing or going away, aberkislag. What does it mean to say that an opposite, if it is not destroyed by the approach of its opposite, goes away? Where does it go? Two cannot accept oddness and remain two. But does it go away? Is going away a genuine option for snow when heat approaches, or is its perishing the only possibility in this case? It is painfully evident that Socrates plants the going away option so that he can conclude that the soul goes away when death approaches. And conveniently, he even has a place, namely Hades, awaiting the soul's arrival. Furthermore, one might doubt that Socrates asking if a thing that is deathless is not also therefore indestructible is a genuine step in the argument as opposed to another setup. Consider, for example, the passage from the Meno at 81b, which cites the words of certain priests and priestesses and of some poets, quote, they say that the human soul is immortal. At times it comes to an end, which they call dying. At times it is reborn, but it is never destroyed. Obeliste, build. Here, the immortality of the soul just is its indestructibility. And we note that Keyes sees no need for an argument to prove that the immortal is the indestructible. And finally, when Socrates concludes that, quote, all would agree that the good, that the God, the form of life itself, and anything that is immortal is imperishable and indestructible, has he not undercut his entire enterprise? For if all forms are immortal and indestructible, no form could admit death, but all would have to perish or depart at death's onset. With perishing not an option, it seems all forms would depart at the approach of death, and so too the god. But where would they all go? To be sure, Socrates has a purpose in arguing for the immortality of the soul, but his purpose is not to prove the immortality of the soul. It is rather, as he explicitly says, to encourage people to live right. That is, to become, quote, as good and wise as possible, close quote, 107b. It would seem, then, that Socrates takes up the matter of causes in order to defend the immortality of the soul, but he defends immortality in order to promote a life of virtue. Why do people want to know if the soul is immortal? Because, as Socrates points out, quote, if death were escape from everything, it would be a great boon to the wicked to get rid of the body and of their wickedness together with their soul, close quote, 107b. Perhaps death's finality would thus serve well someone like the Republic's Catholics. Of course, neither Simmias nor Hebeus is wicked, Unlike someone like Catullus, their reason for raising the question of the immortality of the soul is not that they are hoping death is the end, but because they are hoping it is not. As Socrates comically puts it, causing Hebes to laugh, you seem afraid, like children, that as the soul goes out from the body, the wind may literally blow it apart and disperse it, especially when someone happens not to die in calm weather, but in high wind, close quote. Why is Socrates not similarly afraid? In the Apology, what Socrates fears is the alternative he judges worse upon reflection. When he must choose between doing wrong and death, that is, between something he knows to be both bad and shameful and something whose badness is uncertain, the right choice, the best choice, the choice less to be feared, is the one whose badness is uncertain, death. In the Phaedo too, the right choice seems to be the one that is the better of the alternatives. Note the otherwise gratuitous point Socrates makes in connection with his search for the genuine cause of things. After he says, quote, on this reckoning then it is fitting for one to investigate only about this and other things what is best, close quote, he continues, quote, necessarily the same man knows what is worse, for the same knowledge points to both, close quote, 97b. And he makes the identical point a bit later, quote, I eagerly seized upon Anaxagoras's books and read them as quickly as possible in order to know as quickly as possible the best and the worst. Weiss and Talents, close quote. Socrates in the Phaedo reminds his friends that he determines his course of action by weighing his alternative, quote, acting with my muse, close quote, I choose the best. It is what is best that is thus the cause of his being in prison now in Athens rather than free in Megara or Boeotia. The implication in both dialogues seems to be that fear of death is trumped when there is something to be feared more, something worse, which is its only alternative. As far as Socrates is concerned, all one needs to know in order not to fear death is that it is the best of the available alternatives, or, in other words, that the other alternatives are worse. Once we know that remaining alive is a worse option under the prevailing conditions, one knows to fear life. rather than death. Socrates' tranquility and good humor in the face of death, then, has little to do with the belief in immortality of the soul, though he expresses hope in this regard. As we have seen, Socrates registers his misgivings about the argument he offers for the soul's immortality and indestructibility even before he offers it. Moreover, as we have seen, the argument is not a good one. And after his argument ends, he proceeds to consider the moral to be drawn, quote, if the soul is immortal, close quote. Socrates has indeed warned his interlocutors, and Plato his readers, in advance of the causation arguments that no cause is a real cause unless it is a reasoned and thoughtful consideration of what is best under the circumstances. Thus, Socrates' friends ought to be of good cheer about his death, not because Socrates' soul is not about to end, but because Socrates, recognizing what is worse, has chosen better. When, however, death is not a choice, specifically when it does not involve a choice between acting in accordance with the right and the just on the one side and avoiding death on the other, in other words, when it is not the case that the price of avoiding death is doing wrong, is there not, as Keebes believes, good reason to fear death in such a case, in the absence of any definitive proof that death is not a bad thing? Would it not indeed be foolish not to fear it? It is evident that for Socrates, there is nothing that death could possibly be that would make it worthwhile to live in any other way than justly and philosophically. No matter what is on the other side of the equation, it is always worse to do wrong and to live an unexamined life. Indeed, the very fact that Socrates' interlocutors raise the question of the fate of the soul after death reveals them to be both less than fully philosophical and less than thoroughly virtuous. Anyone who is deeply philosophical or truly good lives as he does because he believes it to be the best way to live. If Simmias and Thebes were such men, they could not doubt the value of having lived philosophically, regardless of what their souls would experience or not experience in Hades. No genuine philosopher gives the matter of the afterlife a second thought. Consider what Socrates says about the true philosopher in the Republic. Unlike the guardians of Book Three, who can be kept from cowardice only by being assured that Hades is not so bad, a true philosopher, a person who has a genuinely philosophic nature, does not have so high regard for human life that he would see death as something terrible. In other words, for a true philosopher, the non-philosophical charms of human life hold no appeal. And so death represents no great loss. Indeed, Socrates describes himself in the Apology as one who, quote, not caring for the things that the many do, close quote, does not, quote, even care about death in any way at all, close quote. Death is simply of no consequence to a true philosopher. The philosopher's experience in life, as Socrates describes it in 84 AD, is one that fills him with confidence and precludes fear. Proof is not only impossible, but irrelevant.
Thank you.
She asked for questions.
Right. I'm not going to ask you to answer the questions, but I've noticed from years gone by that many of the questions asked are not real questions anyway. And I don't want to deprive us of the opportunity to talk about the paper. So if you would like to make a comment or ask a question, that I could possibly pass along to Roslyn. Let's take a few minutes to do that.
Yeah, she asked me to take a note of anything. So if you could like put it in the terms of something that we could just jot down and make sure that she gets it, so she gets it in two versions, then I think that would really benefit her, because she's genuinely interested in your reactions.
Yeah, the first thing that struck me is the sort of the bracketability of the afterlife struck me as very similar to the way it's handled in the Republic, right? Where there's the talk of the afterlife at the beginning, and then they're like, no, we're going to put that aside for 8 books, and then we'll come back to it. Which leads me to question, in the Phaedo, as in the Republic, is their interest due, right? Does the actual argument for afterlife, is there, it may not be necessary, but is there something to it nonetheless? In the Apology, it is as you described. In the Republic, it seems different. So.
Got it. Good. No, I didn't. I'm not answering. I got that. Next.
I'll just shout. So I'm. Also, I'm not sure I got it right, but I'm interested to hear more of Rosalind about the account of fear that she's offering, according to which, if there's a bad thing that might happen to me, I don't fear it if I choose something better. And I'm wondering if that's consistent with the passage right before the right exchange passage, mm-hmm. where Socrates is describing the sort of ordinary virtue that people have. They are afraid of death, but they're more afraid of something like shame. And so that is why they're afraid of some battlefield. That seems inconsistent with the account here that was, I interpreted her account to have, but I'd like to hear more.
May I ask your name, please?
Yeah, Amos Escalan.
Escalan?
Yes.
I can't answer that, but I have no doubt she could. Next.
Hi, I'm Suzanne.
Oh, hi, Suzanne.
Okay. I can just shout. So two kind of, another thing people do is more, right? Two questions that are interrelated. First of all, is she claiming that these are the best arguments you can make for immortality, or is she claiming that these arguments are in some way purposely, that he's kind of purposely signaling that they're inadequate arguments? And then the second question is, if his goal is really to make you not fear death, were there better arguments that he could have given? If so, why didn't he give those? For example, I don't know, something about how Weiss harms the soul, or those sorts of things.
Well, I almost feel like I got to say a word to that. Like, I think what the keynote of Roslyn's work generally is the primacy and importance of virtue as a self-standing thing that every one of us should will to do regardless of circumstances in any case whatsoever. So it's a deep, deep, deep moralism that characterizes all of her work. And so that should be prefaced to whatever reply she would specifically make to that question. I think that she is in the paper made that pretty clear, that it's not the arguments that are for immortality that are important. They want them.
Well,
and in that sense, I think that Roslyn's paper is a brilliant answer to the question that Vasilis asked to Hallvard. In other words, he doesn't need them. Like, in other words, opposite to your instinct, like, he doesn't need them. And that it's totally for them. More, Suzanne?
Well, just maybe then to clarify what the second question was.
Yeah.
If he could argue in those terms, then why bother if he don't want the arguments?
Because they want it. In other words, just this, like the, with the patting of the head that came up from the question of the gentleman who was there, that it's not necessarily for him. It's for the boy. He's crying. He needs a pat on the head. They need the comforting tale. So, like, I think that in opposition to you, she would very much say, no, he doesn't need it at all. As you can see in the apology, he's perfectly ready. And he doesn't need any comforting myth. They do. And he's happy to oblige them in a way that will, maybe from the very flaws of the argument, will help them to be better philosophers. I don't know if she would say that. So could you just summarize briefly what that second question was, because I was too busy answering.
It's okay. Assuming that there were better arguments that he could have provided.
Okay, I'll get
are
there better arguments?
Well, rather, assuming there are, why not provide?
But that's kind of this first question too, right? Because I've got written down best argument for immortality, ? Like, you're worried, like, if this argument isn't a good one, are there better ones?
Yeah. Well, let's talk about this after, just so that you can.
Good, I got it, though. Any others?
Yeah, maybe I just have a suggestion for her.
Could I get your name, please?
Yes, I'm Laura, L-A-U-R-A, Cambiotto, C-A-M-B-I-O-T-T-O.
I got Cambiotto. How did you spell Laura?
Yes, Laura is like in English, Laura.
Oh, Laura. Okay, got it.
But I'm Italian, so Laura.
Got it, I got it.
Okay.
Laura Cambiotto, got it.
Yes, so just a suggestion to frame the notion of fear more specifically. So maybe the first way would be to frame it in a cognitive account of emotion. So say that just because Socrates has not a negative proposition about the death, so that's not, is nothing bad for us, etc., etc., he does not feel fear. But also there are other ways, of course, the physiological way. So Socrates does not have a physical reaction of fear because he has trained his body to accept this state. But also, and it could be interesting to question and develop a bit an inactive approach to fear.
Did you say inactive?
Inactive, yes, inactive fear. So to see how Socrates performs his attitude, his action, in order to don't feel fear this way, so as to do with his type of life, etc.
So, could you just say that one more time?
Other model, but the three could be the first, the cognitive way, the second, the physiological way, body experience, etc. And the third, that for me is promising, but it's necessary to develop a bit, is the inactive approach.
Could you just one more time, Laura, repeat the point you made that included the word performs? How Socrates?
Yes, the inactive way. So that
how does he perform?
Performs. So inactive. How
does he enact?
Yes, enact. Performs as a synonym to say enact. Embody, because they how he embodies his style of life without fear. So as to do, of course, with the care of his.
Thank you very much, Laura. Should be very good.
Okay.
And thank you, and thank you, Will, for reading Roslyn's paper. And we're going to proceed now to our third paper. Our speaker is Radcliffe Edmonds, who has a PhD from the University of Chicago. He is the Paul Shorey Professor of Greek in the Department of Greek, Latin, and Classical Studies at Bryn Mawr, a famous name.
famous charitable. He's written on Eros. Midwifery, myth, Olympus and Plato, magic and cosmology, and mythos liturgy are various topics related to Orphica, including their commitment for Tyrus and the gold tablets. So we have a PowerPoint presentation.
I couldn't quite get away from handing out text, and the paperless thing really threw me. So I'm going to try to flip through with all of this. So the song of the nightingale, wordplay on the road to Hades in Plato's Phaedo. Plato's Phaedo may be considered the swan song of Socrates, his final and glorious burst of philosophic music making before his death. Socrates himself brings up the image of the swan song, but he couples it with other bird songs, the famous songs of the nightingale, swallow, and hoopoe, which are associated with the myth of Procne, Philomela, and Tereus. According to the traditional understanding, these birds, once human, lament the brutal murder and cannibalism of Itys. Socrates, however, argues that this traditional mythic idea is wrong, that the songs are not laments of death, but joyful celebrations. Just so, he urges his companions not to lament his death, but to join in singing the joyful celebration of his release. The words Plato uses in this passage help weave together a number of important ideas in the dialogue as he corrects traditional misapprehensions about death and redefines Hades as an image for the eternal divine realm of ideal realities, inaccessible to the senses and beyond the sensations of the body, something to be approached without fear. The singing Idaean of the nightingale, Idaean, links together the realm of Hades, Haidu, with the unseen Aide, and the eternal Aideon realm of forms, Aide, which the soul can perceive by knowing Aideon, when it makes itself without the pleasures, Aideus, and pains of the body. Rather than a lament, the song of the nightingale is transformed into an incantation that permits the philosopher to face death without fear, Aideos. All of these words, with their combination of A, I, E, and D sounds, resemble each other sufficiently to remind the reader of each other whenever they appear in the dialogue. Plato uses this set of word plays to remind his readers of the ideas discussed in the dialogue, spurring their recollective associations of unseen forms, absence of pleasure and pain, and the absence of fear with the traditional name of Hades. The swan song of philosophy is therefore not a nightingale's lament, but rather an incantation against fear of death. Of all the word plays in the dialogue, the most obvious and explicit connection is between the traditional mythic name of Hades and the unseen. The word play on the name of Hades and the unseen realm of the dead can be found in Homer, and no doubt relates to the magical dog-skin cap of invisibility that appears in myth as Hades. Because of Socrates' impending execution, the dialogue resounds with references to the journey of the realm of Hades, or to conditions in the Hades. Socrates will soon no longer be visible among his friends, but unseen in Hades. The connection is made explicitly in ADD, when Socrates is referring to the soul, the invisible to Aeolus, departing into another such place, which is, like itself, noble and pure and invisible, to the realm of Hades, Ace, Haidu, in truth. For not only is Hades the realm of the invisible, but the souls who go there after death are likewise invisible, even during life. Socrates questions Kebis on the nature of the soul. The shifts in this passage between unseeable aoraton and invisible aides serves to emphasize the final conclusion that the soul is aides, invisible. Only the souls that do not complete the transition to Hades, but linger around the graveyards as ghosts, are visible at all. They're not invisible aides, precisely insofar as they're not in Hades. Souls, however, are not the only things invisible to human sight. The objects of knowledge are repeatedly characterized as ungraspable by the senses, in contrast to other phenomena. And you can see these phenomena, and touch them, and perceive them by the other senses. Whereas the things that are always the same can be grasped only by the reasoning of the mind and are invisible and not to be seen. Those things that can only be grasped by the reasoning of the mind are just as invisible ideas as the soul. The word for this reasoning of the mind is knowing, eidēna, yet another word that recalls the invisible realm of Hades. We can be certain that such a wordplay was in Plato's mind, because in the Crackles, Socrates denies that the name of Hades comes from the invisible, although the name Hades is not in the least derived from the invisible, but far more probably from knowing all noble things, and for that reason it was called Hades. Although there are other words for knowing, the verb eidēnai appears nearly 20 times throughout the Phaedo, and each time it appears, the connection with Hades is recalled. Not only is the verb of knowing reminiscent of Hades, but even the objects of knowledge themselves recall the invisible realm. When something is grasped by the mind in the process of recollection, the thing that is grasped is not a material object or a sense perception, but rather an idea, eidos. Socrates prompts Simmias to think about the way such ideas work. Well, you know that a lover, when he sees a lyre or a cloak or anything else that his beloved is wont to use, perceives the lyre and in his mind receives an image, eidos, of the boy to whom the lyre belongs, do you not? The form in the mind is not the thing seen by the eyes, but the invisible mental image formed by the thinking process. The term eidos is, of course, famously used elsewhere in the dialogue to describe the ultimate object of recollection. The form, given capital letter in modern scholarship, indicated technical usage. These capital F forms are things such as beauty itself, equality itself, threeness, etc. They're grasped not by the senses, but by the mind. The idea, the forms, therefore, are invisible to the senses, ideas. These objects of knowing, Ain and I, are also the things that are always the same, impervious to the flux that characterizes the phenomenal world. Both souls and objects of knowledge are thus undying, since they do not come into being or perish. The invisible, ideas, that does not perish or change is thus characterized as eternal, aedion, an unusual word undoubtedly chosen to recall other words with similar sounds in the dialogue. The forms, aedae, which are the objects of knowing, aedonai, are thus eternal, aedion, and invisible ideas, like the realm of Hades, haidu, is in truth. For the place of the dead is not an unpleasant place to be, an unpleasant place to be feared, but a destination to be welcomed. Joy. Hades is, in fact, linked with the absence of bodily pain and pleasure, sensations that come from the experience of the phenomenal world and its endless variations. Pain and pleasure are never constant and stable, but are always succeeding one another in the body. Socrates jokes near the beginning of the dialogue when he experiences the pleasure of the removal of his prison chains that pleasure and pain are inextricably linked together, as if fastened together in a fable by Aesop. Indeed, the soul that is too closely tied to the pains and pleasures of the body cannot succeed in making the journey to the realm of Hades. Intense pains and pleasures make one suppose the phenomena that cause them are real, and these phenomena are explicitly things that are seen rather than unseen ideas. If the ever-changing perceptions of the bodily senses are taken to be true and real, the soul is bound to the body that senses them so clearly, rather than being able to depart to the realm of the unseen ideas. The soul, therefore, must do without pleasure, ideas, of the body to go to the realm of Hades. The true philosopher, therefore, does not care for sensible pleasures and pains, the transitory affects of the body, but rather cares for the eternal ideal. An invisible ideas, objects of knowledge, aided them. And this care, melite, is the famous practice of death, melite, that brings the philosopher close to the realm of Hades. The only truly unpleasant thing, ideas, that could bring grief for such a philosopher is a failure of argument. Socrates counsels Phaedo not to cut his hair on the next day in mourning for the death of Socrates, but rather they should both cut their hair in mourning immediately, if they're not able to conclude their argument successfully and the logos dies. This true pain and pleasure that the philosopher feels associated with arguments, in contrast to the apparent pains and pleasures of the body, resembles the true fear a philosopher feels about an argument going awry, in contrast to the misguided and illusory fears of the unphilosophic. Explaining the procedure of his second voyage, Socrates refers repeatedly to the fear of the argument being refuted. This fear provides the rationale for the cautious and laborious procedure of explaining things in terms of their participation in the peculiar being of any given thing in which it does participate, all by all. However, the philosopher need not fear anything in the phenomenal world, least of all death. While others who are called brave only appear brave through the fear of other things, choosing death as a lesser evil, because they fear other evils in the world, the philosopher alone does not fear death because he knows that death is not an evil. A philosopher then, like Socrates, is able to face the prospect of death and the journey to Hades without fear, adeos, as Phaedo himself mentions at the beginning of the dialogue. Others not only fear death before it comes to them, doing all sorts of terrible things because of their fears, but even after death comes, those most attached to their bodies and the sensible world fail to separate from their bodies and go to the realm of Hades, held back by fear of the invisible and of Hades. By contrast, those who practice philosophy, the practice of dying, says Socrates, have no fear that the soul might blow away and disperse with the death of the body. This passage concludes the first set of arguments in the dialogue, and it also immediately precedes the image of the swan song and the song of the nightingale. Simmias and Kebbies, however, have already asked for a song to help them with their fears of death, fears which they admit are irrational, even childish. Socrates prescribes an incantation to sing the fear away. You must sing spells, epaidein, to him every day until you have charmed it out of him. The philosophical arguments for the immortality of the soul serve as an incantation against the fear of death, and the philosopher who can make such arguments is thus an enchanter, epoidon, the singer of a potent and magical song. The song, aidein, of the nightingale, aidon, likewise picks up the associations with Hades, not, as the traditional myth would suggest, because of its lament for a brutal murder, but as a similar kind of philosophical incantation. The practice of philosophy is repeatedly associated in this dialogue with making music, from Socrates' dream commanding him to make music, to the requirement that arguments must be in tune with symphone, the initial hypothesis of Socrates' method in his second Salem. All this philosophical singing, like the song of the nightingale, is a way of reminding the listeners, not of the fear of death, but rather of the immortality of the soul. And Socrates urges his interlocutors to repeat the arguments of the dialogue and the accompanying myth over and over to themselves, like an incantation. So what is the significance of all of these associations? The mythical realm of Hades is no more identical the invisible objects of knowledge, then the philosopher is actually an enchanter. But the connections drawn between all these things serve to bring them together in the minds of Plato's readers. The wordplay that associates Hades, Aides, Aidenai, Aidos, Aideon, Aides, Adeos, Aiden, and Aidon does not amount to a serious argument that equates all of these things. The connections are too tenuous, too inexact, too ambivalent. On the other hand, this unusual concentration of terms with similar sounds should not be dismissed as merely play, a relic, perhaps, of Plato's frustrated poetic ambition. Plato uses this cluster of similar-sounding words as a kind of serious play to highlight another issue in the dialogue, the nature of recollection. In addition to the higher level of recollection of the things in themselves, the forms, the Phaedo is notable for references to more mundane kinds of recollection, being reminded of a boy from seeing his lyre, or of earlier arguments by hearing a new one. The set of words that resemble Hades, I would suggest, serves to stimulate this lower level of recollection. Each of these words sets off a chain of recollection that leads the reader from one idea to another, reminding him or her perhaps of the way that knowledge takes invisible ideas rather than concrete phenomena as its objects. or the recollective chain triggered by the words might remind the reader that reliance on knowledge of stable and eternal ideas instead of sense perceptions in flux saves one from fears and ever-shifting pleasures and pains that attend taking sense perceptions as reality. The wordplays thus serve to illustrate the process of recollection discussed in the dialogue, adding another example of the mental process of reasoning involved. Socrates defines recollection not as simply recognizing some object of perception, but also thinking about some other thing in connection with the first thing. If a person, on seeing one thing or hearing it or getting any other perception of it, not only recognizes it, but also thinks of something different, which is the object not of the same knowledge, but of another, do we not rightly say that he is reminded of the thing he gets the thought of? The chain of associations is the key to the process of recollection, which is always a process, not an instantaneous flash of insight. The thinker moves from a sense impression to an associated mental image, from the sight of a lyre or a cloak to the image, eidos, of a beloved boy to whom it belongs. This first example of recollection involves only one step, but Socrates points out that longer chains of association occur as well. Can a person, on seeing a picture of a horse or of a lyre, be reminded of a man? Or on seeing a picture of Simmias, be reminded of Cadmus? Just as a lyre can remind one of a boy who's not physically present to be the object of sense perception, and a picture of a lyre can remind one of a lyre that's not physically present, so too a picture of the lyre can remind one of the lyre, and that thought of the lyre remind one of the boy. Such chains could, in theory, be extended endlessly by the process of reasoning, which can move through similar things or dissimilar things with equal facility. The difference between the thing perceived and the thing remembered always strikes one, the one recollecting. But whenever it is from like things that anyone is reminded of something, does it not also necessarily happen to him that he thinks whether or not this falls short in respect of its likeness of that thing of which he's been reminded? Now, to be sure, some will ponder the differences more deeply than others. Some will merely think that the picture looks very much like Simmias without actually being Simmias. Others, more philosophically minded, may continue the chain of associations, moving further from the initial stimulus of recollection. Well, the first element of the chain is always a sense perception contingent upon the particular appearance in the particular moment and place. Subsequent elements must each be an idea that one grasps in the mind. In some circumstances, perhaps after an elaborate series of dialectical arguments or internal mental maneuvers like Tima's famous ladder, the idea that will be grasped will be the thing itself, auto, beauty or equality or justice, the form, eidos, in the modern technical sense. But in the Phaedo, the discussion of recollection focuses on more concrete things, Simmias or his lyre, for example, or a previous argument. The interlocutor is often asked to be reminded of how a particular argument works. Most trenchantly, when Simmias asks to be reminded how the argument about how all learning is recollection goes. One logos can thus trigger the process of recollection for another logos, whether it's Socrates' updates of the argument for recollection that helps Simmias recall the argument that he had known previously, or whether it's one word that reminds the reader of another. If the reader's recollective process is initiated by the sound or appearance of the word Hades, the chain of associations may lead her back to other words which are similar, such as invisible, eternal, knowing, idea, even incantation. The song of the nightingale can thus provide the reader with the stimulus for recollection of all the other concepts linked by the sounds of the word, as well as the arguments that are built upon each of those words throughout the course of the dialogue. The singing of the nightingale is a reminder that Hades is not fearsome and unpleasant, but the practice of dying is rather a movement of the mind to the invisible world, where the unseen and immortal soul is with the eternal and unchanging objects of knowing. Such a reminder serves as an incantation against the fear of death, a charm against the mormo dukea, who haunts the child in us all when faced with death, These reminders are not the same as the arguments themselves. The ones that Plato provides for his interlocutors about the immortality of the soul in this dialogue and others. Wordplays cannot substitute for the labors of dialectic and the processes of reasoning, but they can serve to start to set the chain of recollections going. The song of the nightingale is no lament, expressing grief in the presence of death, but rather a joyful paean that reminds all who hear it of the beauties of philosophy. Thank you.
Thank you. We have time for some questions. First hand I see is Will.
Well, I love that paper. I want to get you on another. First of all, just think about the theme of the unseen singer. Like, I'm reminded of like a hermit thrush in a summer night in Vermont. You never see the hermit thrush, and it's not much to look at when you see it. But the song is unforgettable. And so I want you to
talk. That's why I had to put the Keats there.
Yeah. So I want you to talk about another sing, the singers that turn into the cicadas in the Phaedrus.
I mean,
What I want to ask you is this: when they're singing, that do you think they realized when they were coming close to death that they were actually kind of hungry, and that they just kept on singing because they wanted to do it so much? But do you think it even crossed their mind before they died that they might actually die, but they were determined to keep on singing?
I mean, the way Plato is setting it up there in the Phaedrus, right, it sounds like they're the perfect philosophers who completely ignored all thoughts of food or anything.
You don't buy that?
Well, it's the story that Socrates is telling, right? I mean,
isn't it the story that Socrates is enacting when he sings the song of the swan? Isn't the great unseen singer of the Platonic dialogues Plato himself?
Well, yes. I mean, I would say that. But I don't think that either Socrates or Plato is at the level of the cicadas, right? I mean, as I think you pointed out, right, Socrates is bringing his young child, you know, to the prison, and you know, he's 70 or something, and he's got a, I mean, neither Socrates nor Plato is entirely divorced from eating and drinking and living in the world. But, right, there's a process, a melete, right, of this separation of devaluation. It's not an absolute. The cicadas are absolute, right? They become insects.
Isn't Socrates singing up until the very point of his death?
Oh, absolutely.
I
totally agree. I think I think the parallel is there. I wouldn't want to push it too hard. You should do it.
Suzanne?
Again, awesome talk. I like that. One question. So, you know, you're noting this really interesting kind of echoing between the words, and then the way you want to catch that up was, so this is going to talk recollections, so you hear the words of Phaedrus, it sounds like it's physical, and then maybe you recollect an argument of the immortality of a soul or something like that. Right? But in a way, you don't have to recollect it when you're reading the field, because the arguments are right there for you. So I'm wondering if there's another way you could catch it up that you can sympathetic to. So what I was thinking about was in the Republic, right, when he's talking about the education of children, right, you're surrounding them with all these beautiful embroideries and all this censorship, right, so that their soul will be prepared to welcome the beauty of reason when the time comes. Mm-hmm. So maybe you could take these kind of verbal accolades that you're pointing to, rather than as prompting full recollection through these philosophical arguments, rather you could take them as being directed either at, I don't know if you want to call it soul parts of the field, but maybe like some rational elements of the person, or directed at people who aren't fully ready for philosophical arguments.
Well, I mean, one of the things I think is important in the Phaedo is that not all recollection leaps all the way to the form. And I mean, there are more examples in the Phaedo of this sort of limited, like, how did that argument go again? Or this reminds me and so the idea that learning is recollection. So absolutely, the learning process in the Republic has to work in some such way. Now, in the Republic, he says, we're not going to set up the myths, right? We're not going to set up the stories that they learn. We're not going to set the texts that they, which is where you would get this. But I think that the idea is consistent with that, absolutely. So,
there's a question over there.
So I like the idea broadly, but I was wondering about Hades in particular,
uh-huh.
and the phrase Hades as it truly is, the hos aletheis, that's there. So part of what I'm wondering about is back at 69 and earlier in the so-called defense speech, Socrates is confident that he will be, will go to Hades and be among wise rulers. And then after the affinity argument, we find out that Hades as it truly is are these invisible things. And for that, it seems like we need something stronger than just word association. But it seems like he's cashing out that, no, when I said that we were going to go to Hades, we were going to go to Hades as it truly is, which are these invisible forms. And so I was just wondering, that seems to be something stronger than the mere the sort of word association.
Absolutely. I mean, as I said, the word play doesn't substitute for the dialectic. It assists it, right? It assists the process of recollection, of learning. Remember that Simmias and Kebbies, right? Socrates has his very close philosophical friends around him, and they're like, wait, what was that argument? Can you remind me how that went? There's a sort of thematization that everybody needs this process as well. So
my thought is that Hades has to literally be identical to the eternal there for his argument to work. He's going to go to Hades. He's confident of that. Hades, as it truly is, just is the invisible. It's not merely reminding us of the invisible. So there, at least, it seemed like you need something stronger.
Right. I mean, you could take that puzzle in two different ways. It could just simply be, and this is how I'm more inclined to take, simply sort of hammering home the pun. You could also say that, no, here Plato is really insisting on the truly existent nature of Hades as the eternal realm of the forms, and I don't see any way you could argue against that, right? Maybe I'm cautious. And I don't want to hang too much on it, but yeah.
In the front.
So I don't speak English, but I will try to dialogue with you. Okay? Can you go back to Phaedo 7:1, please?
To sort of impose a world on it is later Platonic thinking, where they're dividing it very firmly.
For me, it's a great mistake.
It's like when Socrates says to Crito, we have to be careful with language, right? Don't talk about the...
You talk about words, right.
I stand corrected on that. You're right.
There is no world of ideas in Plato and no visible world in Plato because we don't have these words in the opera.
This is where the distinction between Hades, which is a place,
yeah.
and the objects of knowledge which are invisible and ungraspable, which are not in place. That's where there is a distinction between those things. And that's, in some sense, that's one of the reasons why I am cautious about doing what you were saying and sort of really linking them too firmly, because there are distinctions like that. Yeah, no, I think, thank you, that is important.
Okay. There are more questions. I propose that we continue, but
In order to be fair now, I'm going to ask Halper to come up and make your direct questions at both of our speakers. And you, and Will, you're welcome to come if you feel like you can field the Roslyn's questions here. So I think the next question, will be for you, but the floor is now open for questions to any speaker.
I can shout, no problem. All right. Well, thank you so much. I really love this. At some point, I think you said the sound or the appearance of words. I'm curious to know what you think about that. There's a very strange moment in the video in I had it, 102C, when Socrates says something like, I get the impression of speaking syngraphicos, which some people translate as a book. So I'm curious to think also of the appearance of his reading, and if there may be a hint of the predominance, so to say, of the signifying of the meaning in a way.
Yes, that's why I sort of tossed that in, because I mean, there is the question of the, you know, is Plato writing for readers or for listeners or for both? In addition to the syngraphicos, there's when he's talking about the picture of Simeon,
yeah.
It's actually gegramenon,
yeah.
Right? And so a different possible way, and I actually had a student explore this idea in a paper this term, you could take that actually as the writing of. And so you can move the whole thing to the idea of the writing of Socrates as a recollection of Socrates. And so given the way that Plato plays with the status of writing in that, I think that's absolutely
thank you.
Yeah, Olivia.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My question could be for the three talks, despite that this is one of our prospects. But it's somewhat clear. I was wondering if I understand perfectly the distinction to make between the world plays just as for sounds and the implication of that. And I understand too, just a previous question, that you are very cautious about not going too far for the meaning of others, and the distinction between the relation and value. So would it be an argument further for to say that that kind of fear is just cured by epode, incantation, and that finally death cannot be addressed? Well, cure of death cannot be addressed, but with this kind of more playful words and connection things.
Again, I think that Plato has both the dialectic arguments and these word plays figured in with the incantations. And so when he's telling them to sing this stuff over and over again, the recollective element that's spurred by the word plays, I think, is part of that, the over and over again in particular. But I do think that he thinks that, you know, he makes an emphasis on these arguments are worth going over again. And going through step by step in this sort of long, laborious process. So I don't think that it's an either or. I think it's a both and. I didn't
address
what you're. I don't know.
We'll talk to you later.
Okay. I'm going to ask a question myself, and then give Halper a chance to ask a question. This is actually to both of you. I don't know how much all was put into making the session actually coherent, But it strikes me that this, the wordplay that you're talking about, in a way, it's sort of like the opposites, the pleasure and pain opposites. And both of them, stand in strong contrast to the forms, which are supposed to be outer and not related to anything else. So if you really were talking about form, you wouldn't be able to have this wordplay, and you wouldn't be able to have pleasure and pain. You'd have to somehow separate them out. And I'm not sure really what to make of this, because the whole of the Phaedo is filled with wordplay, and it's filled with references to pleasure and pain, and yet we're supposed to come away with it from
Are you asking how forms are connected to particulars?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah,
that's
a little problem.
I'm not on that one.
Actually, I thought it was really, really fascinating about your presentation, and it has something to do with this question as well. You sort of touched upon it already, but I wanted this this association that is in the form of recollection, does it go anywhere? I mean, do you think that, I think that's sort of overlapping with
right,
what
I mean,
in one way you have the, it seems like if you think that that's just a part of us and it will always be there as a sort of something that brings us back to keep us safe somehow, or is it more like a ladder that you can just throw away at some point?
Well, when you use the term ladder, right, it brings us back to the symposium, which is where I went with this, and to your question as well, right? How do you move from the particular instantiations that of something that reminds you of the thing in itself to that thing in itself? And the symposium's ladder is the most sort of elaborate description of that in any of the dialogues. The other place get a similar description is in the Phaedrus, right, where you move from the perception of a multiplicity by reasoning, logismal, right, you move to the unity of it. And so again, you have this process stimulated by, and particularly again in the Phaedrus and the Symposium, physical, visual stimulation of beauty, which in the Phaedrus, right, it's the one that is most accessible to our senses. And so that's a good starting point, and that can lead you to the form, to the beauty itself, the beautiful itself, in theory. The interesting thing is that in the Phaedo, beauty isn't really the issue, right? It's the equal that is far more of a model. And the sort of perception of the gap between the sensible and the idea is what keeps you reasoning on. And so I think it is this continuous process. And how you ultimately bridge the gap is always problematic. Is that fair to say? Parmenides and that was the standpoint. But at least in the Symposium and the Phaedrus and I think the Phaedo, it seems like Plato is saying you can go there, and ultimately, the recollection will lead you not just to thinking of, a picture of a horse to the horse to Kevi, it's Kevi's horse, and Kevius is the friend of Simmias, and so you're thinking Simmias moves the picture of the horse, right? It can get you farther than that.
It's supposed to get you to the form of the equal, which is itself by itself and not related to anything else except this
intangible.
How you could have the equal itself without two things being equal.
Right.
So it's there's
right,
a
paradox. You can't ever get away from the phenomenal, right? Because that is always where an embodied mind starts. Right? You have to start with the physical stimulus.
I don't see any more questions, so let me thank the two physical speakers and the one invisible speaker. And thank you all for both all of you for the session. And